Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Columbia Climate School Summer 2024 Pre-College Program Information Session. Today, we are going to learn all about the Columbia Climate School in the Green Mountains that's being offered by us at the Columbia Climate School and Putney Student Travel. My name is Laurel, Zaima-Sheehy. I'm the Assistant Director of the K-12 and Continuing Education Programs at the Columbia Climate School. And today we are joined by an amazing group of experts that are going to share about their experience in the Green Mountains program as both an expert and an alumni. So on the Columbia side, Sandra Goldmark will be joining us. She is the Climate Action Senior Assistant Dean for Interdisciplinary Engagement at the Columbia Climate School and Director of Campus Sustainability and Climate Action at Barnard College. Kinan Ramirez is also going to be joining us today, who is a Summer 2021 participant. And Kinan is going to be sharing about his experience in the program and where he is now, which is a freshman at Columbia College. And from the Putney side, we have Evan Overton, who is the program director that assists with helping us run the Columbia Climate School and the Green Mountains pre-college program. So a little bit of our run of show. We are going to start with an introduction to the organizations that are behind this pre-college effort, which is the Columbia Climate School and then Putney Student Travel. So you'll hear a little bit of history about our organizations and the motivation to hold these pre-college programs. And then you are going to hear more about the Columbia Climate School and the Green Mountains program, some of the program themes and pedagogy, and you will meet the experts that will be part of the program and hear from Sandra. You'll also get a sense of what it's going to be like, a day in the life of the Green Mountains program. So what the lessons will be, the different team building activities and educational activities that we've embedded as part of the program, that we also have some field-based opportunities for you to get out in the field and collect samples and analyze them, that we will also be taking excursions so you can have a better sense of how some of these solutions are applied in different sectors. And then, of course, we're going to have the opportunity to explore all that Vermont has to offer. So hearing a little bit about those activities as well. We'll also share with you what the next steps and the application process is and answer any questions that you have at the end of the program. So if you do have any questions, you'll notice that the chat is disabled. So please use the Q&A to leave questions whenever it arises for you. We will collect all the questions and answer them all at the end. And feel free to leave questions for our experts as well. They're happy to answer the questions to the best of their abilities. All right. So the Columbia Climate School is the Columbia University School for Transdisciplinary Climate Research. The school was announced in July 2020, and it's the Climate School is the first new school to be established at the university in 25 years. The Columbia Climate School's mission is to develop and inspire knowledge-based solutions and educate future leaders for just and prosperous societies on a healthy planet. The school was really born out of recognition that climate change is one of society's greatest challenges and an intergenerational human rights concern. It will disproportionately impact people that are already severely disadvantaged, and the challenges are difficult and complex and require innovative and coordinated transdisciplinary solutions. So the Climate School addresses these challenges as it's guided by interdisciplinary research, partnerships, education, innovative technologies, and the sharing of ideas with the focus on having a direct impact on the world. Columbia University is a global leader in climate and sustainability education and has a longstanding history of earth and environmental science education and research. The true beginnings really started at Lamont Doherty Earth Observatory over 70 years ago. So LDEO is located 20 miles north of New York City on 189 acres. LDEO is ranked the number one scientific institution in the U.S. devoted to earth and environmental sciences. Columbia University and Lamont's research has been instrumental in the topic of climate change. In fact, the term global warming was coined by Dr. Wallace Broker in 1972. Dr. Broker was a scientist at Lamont and a professor of geology in the Department of Earth and Environmental Sciences at Columbia University. Lamont's research also includes the development of the first model to accurately predict extreme weather associated with the El Nino event. And this just scratches the surface of some of the Earth and climate discoveries that have been generated from Lamont. And the Earth Institute was started in 1996, and it's the largest research institute at Columbia University, with over 750 environmental scientists, managers, policy analysts, engineers, and other experts. Earth Institute was the architect behind many of the programs at the Climate School. EI was established in response to the notion that sustainability, issues of climate, natural hazards, and the relationship between human and society and our environment all needed evidence and research-driven solutions. So EI houses a couple dozen research centers, including the International Research Institute of Climate and Society, or IRI, and the Center for International Earth Science Information Network, or CSIN. The Climate School is really committed to offering these multidisciplinary educational opportunities for graduate, undergraduate, and pre-college students, as we recognize that you all are the next generation of change makers and essential stakeholders to address the climate crisis. So we think that young people are so critical because climate is this long-term problem. Yes, we are experiencing challenges now, but the future generations are going to be the ones that are most affected. So young people need to be a part of the solution in developing the climate technologies, ways to combat climate injustices, and adapt to various climate impacts. And the way we think young people can do this is to be equipped with the knowledge and skills and tools to drive solutions at a young age in this middle and pre-college high school timeframe. So you can carry these solutions right on into your careers. And it's not that we want everyone to be a climate scientist. We really need climate solutions to be embedded into whatever skills, passions, and careers you decide to pursue. Our pre-college programs demonstrate how we can bring earth processes, climate science, and sustainability into every career. You could want to become a climate scientist, but you also might want to be a lawyer or a politician or an artist or a doctor, a professional in any other sector. And no matter what you choose, climate will impact you and you can be a part of the solution. So a core piece of our pre-college programs are delivering education and developing young people into community leaders. Much of this work happens at the local level, so we really need climate activists to mobilize communities and drive change. In our partnership with Putney Student Travel, we are able to offer unparalleled summer experiences for our students to go into the field and on the ground with Columbia Climate School experts. You will be immersed in climate content that a high schooler might not normally have access to. I'm now going to pass it over to Evan Overton to share a little bit more about Putney Student Travel, history, mission, and goals.
Thank you, Laurel. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Evan, and I'm representing Putney Student Travel from our headquarters here in Putney, Vermont. You see on the screen a photo of my colleagues and I. We work out of an old dairy barn on a dirt road. We're a family-run educational organization founded in 1951 and now in its third generation, and we're proud to be a woman-owned educational organization with our leaders, Beckett and Liv, there at the front of the photo. You wouldn't mind going to the next slide, Laurel? Our organization was founded in 1951 by George and Kitty Shumlin, who were World War II dreamers. George was an American military man, part of the liberation of Europe, and Kitty was a Dutch person living under the occupation during World War II. And the two met, fell in love, and decided to start this wonderful organization to turn summer vacation into summer education. And we're really proud of the programs that we offer, many of which are small group traveling programs that go around the world. And our mission is to change students' lives through wonderful educational programming. Our collaboration with Columbia Climate School happens in Vermont. And on the next slide, you'll see one of our directors, Peter Shumlin, who was the 81st governor of Vermont. Our current directors, Becca and Liv, are Peter's daughters. So when Peter was in office, he was part of making Vermont green policy and taking the lead in finding some local solutions to global climate change. We see Vermont as a wonderful place to bring students in the summertime, and teaming up with our partners at Columbia Climate School to provide an experience where students can learn about climate science in a beautiful setting where we can do some field research and we can visit with other experts like the representatives of Burlington Electric that we visit on a day trip to Burlington. Our organization is based on safe programs for students. We have a great record of safety and success and are excited to continue to work with Columbia Climate School to offer these unparalleled programs for high school students across the country and across the world. I will speak a bit more later in our presentation about the application process and the next steps for students who are looking to hold space in the program. But for now, just note that the dates of the program are June the 30th to July the 12th, and it takes place at Vermont State University at Castleton in Southern Vermont. I think I'll pass it back to you now, Laurel, and looking forward to hearing from our alumni student, Kinan.
Thanks, Evan. Perfect. So our pre-college program, as Evan shared, the Columbia Climate School in the Green Mountains, is a campus-based program at Vermont State University's 165-acre campus. Students in the Green Mountains program will be joining a cohort of like-minded students from across the country and the world to learn from each other and collaborate to gain an understanding of the multifaceted aspects of climate change, to learn about the individual roles in climate action, and engage in meaningful conversations about taking action in your own communities. So as Columbia University Climate School based in New York City, you might be asking us why this program is held in Vermont. Well, we find Vermont is the perfect location to learn about climate solutions because Vermont has been a leader in the US for green energy, and they've rapidly increased renewable energy like wind and solar and increased energy efficiency, all while building jobs and lowering electric rates. Vermont is showing the country how one state can move the needle in the right direction in addressing climate change while building a more sustainable economy for its people. Therefore, we find that Vermont State University really is the perfect classroom or laboratory to see how climate science, technology, and policy can be applied to real life. In addition, Putney student travel is extremely well connected in their home state of Vermont, and they're able to connect the students of the Green Mountains program with a diverse network of sustainability practitioners to learn on-the-ground solutions. We also really value field-based excursions and activities and experiences for students. And we have the ability to go out in nature, collect samples, analyze our samples to better understand the ecosystem and past climate by being in this pretty rural and incredible ecosystem of the Green Mountains. So we are really excited to be coming back this summer to Vermont. And we'll also make sure we have plenty of time for students to explore all that Vermont has to offer outside of the classroom, on hiking excursions and different things that they can do just to enjoy themselves in the beautiful Green Mountains. So this is the fourth year that we're offering the summer program. The dates, as Ben said, are June 30th through July 12th. So it's a 13-day, 12-night program. The fee is $6,790, and this is an all-inclusive fee that covers accommodation and meals, program activities, the field excursions that I mentioned, and transportation during the program. And this program is a pre-college program, so it really is designed for grade 9 through 12, but we do accept rising ninth graders that are really interested and motivated in climate solutions. Okay, so last summer, we had an incredibly creative Putney facilitator that created this video just to give you a sense of what being a part of the Green Mountains program is like.
Stretch my hands out to the sky. We dance with monsters through the night. Whoa, oh.
Hi, everyone. Sorry for the technical difficulties, but I hope that little video gave you a sense of what it might be like if you were to join us this summer in the Green Mountains program. Now, we would love to hear from Kinan, who is an alumni from the 2021 program, a little bit more to just hear about your experience and where you are now. Hi, Kinan.
Hi, everybody. I'm Kinan Ramirez. I'm currently a freshman at Columbia University. I went to the Columbia Climate Program the summer of my sophomore year. So this was at the beginning of my high school career, I guess. At the time, I had an interest in climate action, but wasn't really like the most informed. But it was like one of my passions that I wanted like to continue. So I decided to go on this trip. And I found it very fun and very informative. One of my favorite parts of this trip was a couple of the professors give simulations of like different things. And one of the simulations that I remember was like a climate action preparedness program. And you basically just go in and they give you like a like natural disaster. And then they give you some resources like to read up on, and you have to act as if like you were like the first responders. You jump into the event and then you got to like deal with everything. And you get a team, so you get to collaborate. But overall, I had a lot of fun during that program. And then after that program, it actually inspired me to take my school on a trip to Florida to go do some research at the Everglades. Very basic research, but it was more of like to get my class and my classmates to get more informed on like climate change and like the Everglades themselves and how they're going to be affected. So we looked on the carbon that the Everglades actually contain to protect themselves, and then as well as salt water that's because of the sea levels are rising, they could now be affecting the Everglades.
Wow, that's an incredible experience that you were able to kind of take some of the things that you learned from this program and apply it into this incredible opportunity to go visit the Everglades to kind of better understand how climate's impacting this really sensitive ecosystem. That's amazing. And Kinan, when you were a sophomore in high school, what in particular about this program made you want to apply?
Well, actually, my freshman year of high school, we had a science fair at my school. And one of my teachers was really challenging me to do something like I wouldn't normally be interested in. So they gave me sustainability as my like topic for the science fair. And because I'm from Phoenix, Arizona, one of the things we deal with is like extreme heat. So I took some time and like a lot of tries to come up with like a good like experiment. And I started to look at the things that like Arizona has problems with. And with some research, I found that we have what's called a concrete oasis effect, which is basically the concrete in all the cities absorbs the heat and then dissipates it slowly throughout the night, leaving the city really hot in the summertime and the rest of the year. So my actual experiment was testing concrete to like the natural Arizona dirt clay. And I was like measuring how they dissipated heat over time and how they absorbed heat, how hot each surface got and all of that.
Wow, that's incredible. And something that you were able to do at such an early point in your high school career. And it sounds like it kind of inspired you to continue learning about climate impacts and maybe drove you to apply for the Green Mountains program.
Yes, absolutely.
Oh, that's great. And so you mentioned now you're at Columbia University. You're in your freshman year, right?
Yes.
And how has the program helped prepare you for college as like a pre-college program? Has it kind of shaped your interests in your freshman year of college at all?
I actually do think it did, because first you have the lectures and you don't get to choose like what time the lectures are for this program. You either have to wake up or you're going to miss them. And I think a lot of the professors do a good job of like keeping the information at a digestible level, but it's still challenging. You have to keep attention. And if you're not used to like a long lecture, it helps you like build, or it helps you get like more comfortable with it. And then my transition to Columbia, the lectures are an hour and a half or an hour 15 minutes, and it's just straight information. You got to be like consistently taking notes, paying attention.
Wow. That I feel like there are some pieces of the program that probably prepare you for some of these really intense lectures. Luckily, because we're in the Green Mountains, we also like to take advantage of different learning modalities. So lecture is one way that we learn. And then we also have a lot of hands-on activities. And as you said, simulations that we'll talk about in just a moment to kind of give you a real world taste of how to apply some of the information that you're learning from the program into different scenarios. So I'm glad it helped prepare you. And then I guess more on like the, you know, college readiness side, was this your first time living in a dorm and eating at a dining hall and being amongst, you know, 80 other students?
No, yeah, it was my first time ever being away from like home for like I would say a set amount of time. Like I knew going in it was 2 weeks, but it's just something I've never been or done before. And I actually had a roommate who I've never met in my life. I came into this program not knowing anybody, but everyone was just like super nice. You'll create friends right away. It's sad to let them go, but it is what it is. And yeah. It was really fun.
Oh, well, I hope you still keep in touch with some of your friends that you made in the Green Mountains program. And so what are you majoring in now? And do you find any like cross-cutting correlations between your major now and some of the climate information that maybe you learned in this program?
Yeah, so after junior year, I took a class in economics, and I that was like my new passion, but I applied to Columbia University with an intended major of economics. And now that I'm in Columbia University, I want to study more on like economic sustainability. So it's more of like about green infrastructure and like developing sustainable consumption. So I think a lot of it has been inspired from the program itself, and it kind of led me to where I was now, even though I didn't think it would have. My mom said it would have, and I didn't listen to her. I just thought like, oh, whatever. But now I'm here, and it is what it is.
Well, that's really great. I'm glad that your mom was right. And, you know, moms have a tendency to be right sometimes, but I'm so glad that you're finding a lot of, you know, pathways from this program that are applicable to your major now in economics. And that's really, that's one of the take-home messages of this program. As I kind of mentioned earlier, no matter what area you go into, what career path you want to pursue, climate will impact you, and you need to think about ways to make each sector more sustainable. So you can really drive solutions in no matter what field you choose. So even for the students that leave the program and don't want to become a scientist, that's great. We don't need everyone to become a climate scientist. So I'm so, so happy and proud that you're taking things that you learned in this program and applying it into your economics major. That's really great. Kinan, any last pieces of advice you would give anyone that's interested in this program?
Honestly, just go for it. You'll have fun. You'll meet interesting people. I still have friends today that I've met my sophomore summer of high school. As long as, like, it might seem short, but it's like, it's been a while.
Oh, that's great.
Definitely memories.
Oh, I'm so happy. All right, everyone that's here, if you have questions for Kinan, I encourage you to put them in the Q&A. He's going to stick around and answer any questions that you have from an alumni at the end of the session. Thanks, Kinan. We'll bring you back at the end. All right, so to go over a little bit of the program themes and some of the topics that we're going to be covering, we do place a strong emphasis on academics because this is a pre-college program. Each summer, however, the program content varies based on the feedback that we receive from participants. So this year, the themes are the science of climate change, climate impacts and resilience, international climate policies and negotiations, sustainability and circular economy, community engagement and climate action and activism. So we're going to actually kind of break down what each of those broader program themes by introducing you to some of the experts and giving you a little taste of some of the activities that they embed in their lectures as well. So we have six Columbia Climate School experts that will be leading the lessons and activities for the Green Mountains program. The experts of the program are leaders in a variety of sectors, including climate science, social science, sustainability, finance, and policy, and all are equipped with, all are committed to equipping students with the tools they need to take action local and global climate impact. So our first expert is Laurel De Serra. Laurel is a graduate research assistant at the International Research Institute for Climate and Society, or IRI. She researches how mosquito-borne diseases are impacted by climate, and she focuses on assessing and improving sub-seasonal to seasonal forecasts and how these models can be used by decision makers to improve the livelihoods of their constituents. So Laurel co-teaches the climate science primer, and she teaches the science of climate change lessons. Our next expert is Miriam Nelson. Miriam is also a graduate student in the Earth and Environmental Sciences at Columbia University and at NASA Goddard Institute for Space Studies, or NASA GISS. She is interested in how severe hazards will change under warming and vulnerability of people and ecosystems to these changes. She uses large-scale climate data sets and model simulations to investigate regional climate and ecosystem dynamics related to precipitation and drought. Miriam also has a background in creating educational videos about climate change to promote environmental advocacy. So if you are interested in climate communication, be sure to talk to Miriam about her experience in that. And Miriam co-teaches the Climate Science Change Primer with Laurel De Serra. And she also teaches the climate modeling and projections lesson. Josh DeVincenzo is a senior project coordinator and instructional designer at the National Center for Disaster Preparedness. He focuses on developing learning experiences associated with FEMA training projects that navigate housing and economic recovery. So Josh teaches the climate change communication and climate change conversations lessons. So he's going to prepare you to be equipped with the skills to talk to different audiences about climate. And he also leads the preparedness tools and strategies lesson. And Martin Dietrich Brauch, he is a lead researcher at the Columbia Center on Sustainable Investment. He leads economic and legal research, training, and advisory work with a focus on legal and policy frameworks and practices for sustainable investment to achieve climate change mitigation and adaptation goals. So these goals include decarbonization and a just transition to net zero emissions energy systems and economies and other sustainable development goals. So Martin teaches the Sustainable Development Goals in the Paris Agreement lesson, decarbonization pathways, monitoring and measuring progress, and global governance and international law. And Sandra Goldmark is actually here with us today, so I'll let Sandra introduce herself.
Hi, everyone. Thank you, Laurel. Hi, guys. Sorry, I'm coming to you from home because it is a major snow day here in New York. For those of you who are not in New York, sorry you missed it. And I hope the New Yorkers are going to go out and enjoy the snow like I did. So as Laurel said, I am a professor at Barnard College, where I also run the sustainability office. And I'm an assistant dean at the Columbia Climate School. And I am so excited to come back for a second summer at Climate School in the Green Mountains. Last summer, I taught a couple of days on the circular economy, and we're going to do that again. And the point of that session is to really dig into this topic. What is circularity? You've heard about reuse. You've heard about recycling. It's really beginning to understand in a holistic way the way we make and produce objects and food to some extent, and how we can come up with more circular regenerative systems. And these basic principles that we'll explore are applicable to all kinds of things, from your everyday life to entrepreneurs and people developing business models, to people pushing for organizational change in their schools or their communities. Circular economy principles are not abstract. They are real things. They are applicable, and they're things that people can take back to their communities and put into action tomorrow. And while I have the mic, special shout out to Laurel and the team who put together this program. I just came up to teach last summer, and I wound up having a wonderful time with the students. I went raspberry picking. I went on a hike with the students. It was really a wonderful time. So I hope to see some of you there this summer as well.
Oh, thank you, Sandra. We'll hear a little bit more about some of Sandra's lessons on circular economy in just a moment, but that was a wonderful introduction. And I will also be an expert in the program. So I actually have a background in marine science and biology and a master's of science in sustainability science. But in the past, over just about a decade now, I've been really focused on climate and environmental education with various audiences, including high school students, but more broadly, K-12 students, teachers, professional learners, and the general public, to better teach people about climate solutions that they can bring to their own communities and ways to garner support around climate action projects. So I'm going to be helping students really develop your own climate action project. I'll teach some lessons about what different climate impacts are in your own community, how you can combat these climate challenges with action plans that are developed by you as a student, and then empowering youth for change. So how do you, after the program, take this project that you've developed and implement it and make it into a real thing? So the work doesn't end at the end of these 2 weeks. Our goal is for you to continue on and really drive that positive change in your own community. Oh, I'll also be leading some of the field-based activities. So in the video, if you saw them, you know, going fishing in the nearby lake, that's actually a biological survey, so we can better understand the local ecosystem, what the water quality is like. We also can do a similar type of assessment in nearby creeks. We can core trees to look at past climate. So I'll touch a little bit on that in more detail in a moment, but I lead a lot of the field-based activities as well. In addition to the academic rigor that we ensure in the program, students also have an opportunity to learn from each other in purposeful activities and immersive experiences. So we have a speaker series, as Kinan mentioned. There are some lectures, but we also have various activities that build teamwork and networking opportunities for you all as young people. We have a handful of excursions that we're going to be taking. Some are half-day excursions, let's say, to a sustainable farm to learn about different farming practices that are better for the earth and climate. And then we'll take some all-day excursions to Burlington to learn from some sector professionals from Burlington Electric. And we'll go to Lake George for a day to learn from the Dairy and Freshwater Institute about their instrumentation that they have to track climate changes in Lake George. So we have a lot of field-based excursions that allow students to learn about different tools that are being used to track climate impacts, as well as solutions that are being employed in different sectors. We have small group workshops and activities. Almost every lesson, every expert that you just heard from has different activities that allow students to apply the skills that they learned from the lecture into a project. And then we have lots of opportunities to explore Vermont that are mostly just fun, like berry picking, and maybe we'll go to an alpaca farm. And the big one is your climate action project. This is something that you are developing throughout the 2 weeks that you are going to take home and implement to drive that positive change. And we're going to help you through that process every step of the way. Okay, so we wanted to give you a sneak peek at some of the program content and lessons and activities that you can expect to be a part of in the Green Mountains program. We do not have any prerequisites for the acceptance into this program. We recognize that everyone is starting their climate journey at different points. So we start with the climate science primer. So all students have this foundational knowledge that we can build on throughout the program. Again, this climate science primer is going to be led by Laurel DeSera and Miriam Nelson. It really focuses on the differences between weather and climate, the various types of climate classifications, how climate influences our societies, a primer on earth science and review of the different earth spheres, and then a function, the function of radiation and greenhouse gases. This is a really fun activity that we did that kind of demonstrates radiation and greenhouse gas function. It probably doesn't look like much, but I'm going to share this video and hopefully explain it after. But if I get booted from Zoom, I'll just pop right back in.
Come on, Destiny!
Okay, so in this activity, you can see that there were three people. Hello, sorry, technical difficulties again. So essentially, hopefully you were able to watch this video. These are the greenhouse gases that are trapping the heat that are being re-emitted from the earth, which is this tiny little frisbee. So everyone kind of started as light coming from the sun, and then trying to re-radiate against the earth. And more, if you were captured by a greenhouse gas, you then became a greenhouse gas. So you can see all these greenhouse gases are catching more and more of that infrared radiation and warming the earth. So that's like a little explanation of this demo that was done, but it really ended up being a really fun game that we all played. Okay. So the next lesson is the preparedness tools and strategies. This is led by Josh DeVincenzo from the National Center for Disaster Preparedness. So this is a really fast-paced activity that facilitates an understanding of the emergency notification process of a county government during and after the remnants of a major natural or unnatural disaster. So again, Josh works very closely with FEMA. So these types of activities are actually real life scenarios that are modeled off of what a government call center has to do after a disaster strike. So students are really experiencing these challenges that might be encountered and are forced to think collaboratively through solutions in a really emergency, fast-paced scenario. So I'm going to play this for you all. Hopefully I don't get booted. We'll see.
Don't touch the water. Don't break the water. Don't drink the water. Don't use the water. Don't bathe the water. Don't smell the water.
Hello? Okay. So in this activity, you can see there's some contamination with the water, but you can hear the audio of the call center happening in the background. That is intentional. That is kind of to spark and basically create the scenario of what it is actually like during a disaster event. Oh, okay. The next type of example that we wanted to provide you all is a lesson taught by Martin Dietrich Brauch on decarbonization pathways. So he really shares about a broad range of policy approaches and technologies that are needed for the rapid reduction of CO2, including but not limited to energy efficiency, behavior changes, electrification, renewables, hydrogen and hydrogen-based fuel, bioenergy, and carbon capture use and storage. He also really focuses on climate injustice, global climate injustice. So there was actually in the UN Environmental Emissions Gap Report of 2020, there was a quote that says, "The emissions of the richest 1% of global populations account for more than twice the combined share of the poorest 50%. So we have these high income and emerging economies that they have the greatest share of historical emissions and have this responsibility to take the lead in climate mitigation. Meanwhile, we have lower income countries that have had the least contribution toward climate, and yet they are disproportionately experiencing the burden and the negative impacts of climate. So Martin really takes deep dives into the climate injustice on a global scale and on a local scale as well. And in terms of kind of applying some of the things that we learned into different activities, all the students of the Green Mountains program, they come together to participate in a climate negotiations, which is a role-playing game that is really based on an international climate summit. So some of these summits that happen at COP each year, this is modeling that scenario. So students role play as different delegates representing different nations or negotiating blocks, and in some cases, interest groups. I think I was a part of the fossil fuel interest group last year, which was really challenging to negotiate on that side, but it kind of helps give you an understanding of what some of the arguments are taking place at these conferences and why it can be so challenging when negotiating with all these different interest groups, how to develop a plan that is really staying below that 1.5 degrees C benchmark. So it's a really great way for students to apply the skills that they've learned and also kind of pull out some of these negotiating and debate skills. And we also have the three circular economy lessons led by Sandra. So maybe I'll let Sandra pop in again and share a little bit more about the sequence of these three lessons.
Hi again. So yeah, as Laurel said, it's basically an introduction to the circular economy. What is it? How does it relate to climate change and other sustainability challenges? And also, how does it relate to social goals and social questions? And the basic structure is there's a little bit of a quick lecture, and then very quickly we break the students into groups and we have them do we've been calling a make it circular project. So they pick an object or a service that is currently structured in a linear way, and they think through the business proposition, the user experience, and they make it circular. So one of the, and then they have to pitch it. And the pitches were really awesome last year. One of my favorite ones was a group of students that took on burial services and coffins and really pitched a really convincing mushroom-based burial program that was a really great, they really thought it through really carefully, and they also did a great job telling the story of it. So we're introducing them to some of these concepts. We're giving them a chance to get on their feet and get in small groups and really think through what it would take to make some of these ideas real in the real world. And then we're also giving them secretly a chance to practice their presentation skills. And you can see they had fun, especially during the presentations.
Thanks, Sandra. I think they did too. That particular project stuck out to me as well. You can like lightly see their presentation in this picture here, but all the presentations were incredibly creative and really showed the teamwork of each of the groups. All right, so we also lead a variety of these field-based activities that allow students to gain technical and research-based skills through field data collection and analysis. So students don't engage in their own formal research project, primarily due to time constraints of this program. It's only 2 weeks. Usually research projects can take multiple months, and even that is a very short time frame for a full research project. However, in this program, we do a lot of research-based activities that provide students with unique sampling fieldwork experiences and the opportunity to apply skills in data analysis. And these are the skills that will really be critical for you all going into college. These activities really also provide a day in the life snapshot of a biologist or a climatologist or an earth scientist. So if you're interested in some of these fields, you might get kind of a sense of what it might be like. So one of our first field-based activities was surveying macroinvertebrates in a stream to assess water quality. So macroinvertebrates are these tiny aquatic bugs that start their life in water before they metamorphose into flying or land insects. So, for example, a dragonfly, you may be familiar with the dragonfly, they actually start their life as a little aquatic water bug. So it's incredible. And each one of these different aquatic macroinvertebrate species have a different hardiness or tolerance to water quality. So let's say we find a diversity of species and some of the most sensitive species, it might be an indication that we have good water quality in an area. And this is a type of protocol that's actually used by different municipalities all over the country because it doesn't require a lot of expensive equipment and it uses no chemicals like a lot of other water quality sampling procedures might use. We'll also take a visit to Lake Beaumassine to survey fish and aquatic animals, conduct some water chemistry tests that do, as I mentioned, kind of have some of those reagents to test water quality. And then we'll also engage in some sediment coring. So climate has local impacts, and this can be assessed by a long-term data set to track these different changes. And while some of these sampling protocols are only a one-day sampling event, you're contributing to a multi-year database of information. So your 1 year of sampling this summer will contribute to every summer us going back and sampling this area so we can kind of get a sense of what climate impacts might be happening in this particular ecosystem. So for example, we can analyze the water quality through the hardiness of species that we catch, similar to the macroinvertebrate survey. We can also test it through some of the water chemistry tests that we do, like dissolved oxygen. And local climate impacts can decrease the amount of dissolved oxygen in a lake. So it's not a one-for-one. It's not like we can say, oh, there's low oxygen in this area, so it must be experiencing like climate impacts, extreme heat. There are a variety of scenarios that could be playing a role into that result. But I think having that long-term database will give us more information to be able to assess and better come to some conclusions about what the driving reason for that scenario is if we do find low oxygen. Sediment coring is actually something that can tell us on this scale, our sediment cores are only like this big. It can tell us about the speed of the water moving in the area. However, the process of sediment coring, actually, when they are grabbed from the ocean that are extremely long, tells us about past climate. So people use ocean sediment cores as a proxy for climate. So we can better understand what the climate was like in the past. So our process of sediment coring will kind of demonstrate what an ocean sediment core will be doing. We'll go through the same type of process just on a core that's this big as opposed to one that's like kilometers long. Another field sampling activity that we'll do are actually taking a tree ring core. Tree rings can tell us about past climate. And there's actually an entire research group at Lamont Doherty Earth Observatory that is dedicated to dendrochronology. So we are going to be using the same tools that this lab uses to core a tree. And it doesn't hurt the tree. We're just taking a small sample to look at the rings of a variety of different local trees in Vermont. And we can analyze what the past climate was like by looking at each of the tree rings and matching it with some temperature and precipitation data. So we're going to be able to take these samples, bring them back, and analyze them back in the lab or the classroom. We also, as I mentioned earlier, do excursions so students can learn about solutions in different sectors. We're going to spend an entire day in Burlington, Vermont to hear from a panel of sector experts that are implementing sustainability into their own work. Burlington was one of the first U.S. cities to source 100% of its electricity from renewable sources. So students will be able to visit Burlington Electric to learn about how they were able to achieve this very ambitious goal and about some of their community-based educational approaches that encourage residents to save their energy. So we'll have the ability to hear from some of these experts, and also we'll spend some time exploring Burlington and the Lake Champlain area as well. We'll also do an excursion to the Darren Freshwater Institute at Lake George. This is really an opportunity for students to learn about how climate is impacting this region and Lake George in particular. We might even get a chance to sample there and then compare our sample from Lake Bomasene to our samples in Lake George, and maybe come to maybe some hypotheses of why there might be some differences there as well. And then of course we're gonna be able to explore Vermont. So Sandra mentioned that we go berry picking, that's right down the road from us. There's also a local person that raises alpacas, so we might be able to meet some alpaca, go for hiking, go to the beach. This Vermont is gorgeous in the summer, and we also want you all to explore this incredible landscape as well. Project-based learning is really critical for students to be able to apply your knowledge into skills that can drive real change. So as I mentioned a little earlier, every student will develop their own climate action plan to address at least one climate challenge that their community faces. These can be adaptation, mitigation focused, or both, depending on your project. So we've had a huge diversity of projects developed from students, such as there was a student from Texas that created a wetland restoration and education project. His education curriculum that he developed with an NGO is actually being implemented into schools today, which is just incredible. Someone else had the idea of a prom dress swap, or like an online thrifting for prom dresses in particular, to reduce waste, because so many times you have a prom dress and you wear it once and then you never use it again. So why not create more circularity around something that's more linear? Someone else wanted to decarbonize their school's website. So basically intentionally using certain coding that would reduce the amount of energy used by a website. That I felt like was so unique and creative and really leveraged some of her skill sets in coding. So there's a variety of different projects that you can, of where you could take this. And we kind of help you think through what your interests are, where your skill set lies, and what change you want to bring back to your community, and then help you create this plan. And you'll have a chance to present in a very short presentation, just to get feedback from the experts and your peers. And then we'll be joined by Pete Shumlin, the 81st governor of Vermont, as a keynote speaker at the end of our celebratory dinner of the program. So I also wanted to share that if you wanted to hear a little bit more about young people's role in climate action, I actually was able to ask some of the alumni of our pre-college programs to share a little bit more about where they've taken their climate action plans now that the program is over. So we don't have time to go into it today, but if you do want to hear a little bit more about the incredible alumni of our program, feel free to check out this Climate Live K-12 video on our Climate School YouTube. It's called Young People's Role in Climate Activism. And I do want to mention that if you are familiar with the Columbia Climate Corps travel programs that ran in summer 2022 and 2023, I did just want to mention that we will no longer be offering these programs. But if you are looking for international programs, you can check those out at Putney Student Travel's website. Okay, so I'm going to pass it back to Evan to talk about the application and next steps on how to apply.
Thank you very much, Laurel. Thank you everyone for joining us. So the next steps for students who are interested are to go to the website, and you'll see the link to our applications page. Our applications are done on a rolling basis, so that means there's not a specific due date, but we do encourage you to start an application sooner than later. The first step would be the family creating a family profile with the contact information for at least one parent, and then their student profile. And then to hold space on the program, the family makes a $700 payment composed of a $200 application fee and a $500 deposit to the program fee. That $500 deposit is refundable up to March the 15th if, for whatever reason, the applicant decides to withdraw their application. And if your application is rejected outright, the entire $700 payment would be returned. But once the $700 payment is made to hold space, the rest of the application portal opens for the applicant to write their interest statement, just a short essay about why they want to be a part of the program, and to input the contact information for two teachers to serve as their educator references. Our system will send to those teachers our educator reference form, and it'll be a quick process for teachers. We know how busy teachers are, so it's something for us to learn a bit more about the student and make sure the student's going to be a good fit for the program. Aside from that applicant interest statement and the two educator reference forms, we just need the parent and student to sign an agreement form, which is a digital form done through our system. And once we receive those three items, our team will make a quick acceptance decision and get back to the family. If you have any questions about this process, feel free to give us a call at 802-387-5000 or email us at columbiaclimateschool@goputney.com. We love to connect with families and make sure our processes are clearly explained and any doubts are answered. Aside from that, we also did want to make sure to mention that we do have scholarship opportunities for this program. So both full and partial scholarships are available. To apply for a scholarship, applicants need to reside in the United States and meet the other eligibility guidelines of the program, mainly being that they are in the grades 9 through 12 of high school. We also do consider rising freshmen or current eighth graders. We're looking for passionate students who have a passion for climate science and climate change, who demonstrate interest in climate advocacy. To apply for the scholarship, it is a separate process than our standard application. So take a look at the link on the screen or take a look at our main website and look for the link to scholarships where you can learn more about that application process. The scholarship application is due on March the 15th, and we do need to receive all required items in order to consider the application on that date. I think that's all about our process. I know that we have some great questions in the chat right now, Laurel, and I think you already answered one of them in terms of some examples of past climate action projects. I was thinking of Sienna, an alumni student who joined us last week from Memphis, Tennessee, kind of a similar thought as I think what Kinan was working on in terms of an urban environment, heat islands, but was more related to green space and tree cover in Memphis, and working with community groups to see what they could do to petition the local government to create some green spaces in areas of the city where they had not previously existed. But I don't know if you want to speak any more about other climate action projects. I think the one that was really, I think, a great one for you to perhaps answer live was the question, as a freshman in high school and someone searching for academic interests, this program seems like an incredible opportunity and very promising, and I might be interested in climate and sustainability. Would you say this program is geared towards people who are strongly committed to climate and sustainability, or would this be more friendly to students who are new to the field?
Great question. So if you are climate curious and motivated to drive positive change, you're a great fit for the program. You do not have to come in as a climate expert. You do not have to have a huge background in climate and sustainability. We encourage you to apply and join us no matter what stage you're at in your climate journey. As long as you're really focused on wanting to bring positive change to your community in the face of climate impacts, I think you're a great fit for the program. I do see a few others here. Let's see. So we have a current eighth grader that is really excited about this experience and climate science.
One we just actually went over, Laurel. I'm sorry. I think the one that...
Okay.
Oh, so sorry. Excuse me. That's not the one that we read. That was the question I think Kinan might be able to speak to.
Oh, great. Okay. So the question says, as a current eighth grader, this sounds like an incredibly valuable and educational experience, as climate science in action is very important to me. I've never been to a pre-college type program, and I'm aware that there's a relatively wide range of age groups that would attend this program. Considering this, I'm wondering what the social experience is like from the perspective of an alumni. So Kinan, if you're able to answer that question, I think it'd be great.
It's definitely a mix of all ages and grades. I got there my sophomore year, but there are definitely some people older than me. At least my year, I think most of us were freshmen, sophomores. But everyone is super nice. So definitely make friends. It's just a good trip overall.
Amazing. Yeah, and we, even though I think I mentioned earlier, we might have a cohort size of anywhere from like 65 to 80 students. And so we recognize that learning is oftentimes best done in smaller, more personal groups. So all the students are broken up into smaller learning cohorts. So you have the ability to make friends within your learning cohort, but then also have the ability to meet and mingle and learn from other cohorts as well. So if you are more on the younger side of this program, I think socially, I think it will be a great learning experience for you as well. So there are a couple of people that are excited and want to hear more from alumni from the program. So Kinan, perhaps if it would be all right with you, if some people could maybe like ask you more questions offline.
Yeah, of course. Should I drop like my email in the comments or one of the questions?
I would encourage any applicants who might be interested in speaking with Kinan or other program participants to get in contact with us at Putney Student Travel. I'd be happy to put, if you're specifically interested in getting in touch with Kinan, to put you in touch with him by email. And we do have references of other families who have traveled with us that could provide a perspective. Typically, we would be providing the contact information for the parents of that family, but I think that would be a fine way to get in touch with another family and getting contact to, you know, from that student perspective.
Perfect. Thanks, Evan. And thanks, Kinan. So someone also asked, is this available as a recording? Yes, absolutely. So this entire information session has been recorded. You're going to be able to find it on our Green Mountains webpage, as well as our Climate School YouTube. So if you are not a part of our mailing list, I also suggest you sign up just to stay up to date with deadlines and new information about the program. I'll also be sharing the recording with anyone who's on our mailing list. All right. So last call for any questions that there may be, and apologies for going a couple of minutes over and my technical difficulties. Sometimes Zoom does not always work in my favor. But thank you so much for joining us for the past hour to talk through our pre-college program. If you have any questions, as Evan said, feel free to contact us via email or by phone. We'd be happy to even set up a video call with you to kind of answer any questions you may have about the program. And we hope to see you this summer in Vermont.